Kocher and Company, a corporate law firm based in Delhi, India. And today I'm going to speak about criminal laws for startups. I understand that if not all, most of the participants here are startup founders or going to be startup founders. So I'm limiting my talk on the very basic criminal law which could be relevant to your businesses. If you have any queries, you could raise them when the query session begins. I'll just take a minute to tell you about Kocher Law Firm. We are one of the fastest growing law firms, extensive legal service for startups and new age companies. We're the first Indian law firm to have obtained a foreign lawyer's registration from the Ministry of Justice, Japan, to practice Indian law in Tokyo. In the Premier Legal Era Award category, our managing partner, Mr. Rohit Kocher, was conferred the Outstanding Achievements Award. Kocher & Company was conferred the Best Real Estate and Construction Law Firm of the Year by Legal Era, which is a law magazine, for people who don't know. We were conferred the Best Law Firm of the Year Award in Bangalore. And these are just a few of the many awards we have received in the recent past. Here's my brief profile for all of you. I won't go through it. I won't waste your time by talking about myself. So I'll just let you know what I do. I basically help a lot of startups in the area of white collar crimes. I mentor them and represent them in the courts. I basically initially teach them how to even unintentionally not get into doing something which is illegal. Jack Dorsey, who was the co-founder of Twitter, once said, make every detail perfect, but make sure that you limit those details to be perfected. So basically, I'm here to talk about something on the same line, to tell you that there could be instances where, even with all good intentions, even with the best of business plans, even with the best of business partners, even with the best of funding companies who are there to support you and to fund you, you could unintentionally get into trouble. So I'll basically tell you in a very simple way, in a layman's way, what to do and what not to do in those particular instances which could be interpreted to be going into the area of criminal law. Now, why criminal law is a must for any new entrepreneur? Why you should know what criminal law is? The reasons are given here. I'll just read them one after the other and give a brief explanation. You see, most of the business-related legislations fall in the realm of criminal law as well. Whether those are corporate laws, whether those are factory laws, whether those are industry regulation laws, they are penalties which could actually, other than penalizing you in terms of money, could send you into prison if you do not follow those basic laws. Failed business or money transactions often lead to police complaints. I might have good intentions. I'm an entrepreneur. I take money from you. You are a funder. And I tell you, I'm going to invest in ABC business. I intend to do that, but somehow I'm not able to. The money gets spent up. The other party has the right to go against me by law. Unintentional, inappropriate, and promised use of money funded for business may lead to criminal implications. This I just explained to you. HR policies by law require examination in respect of criminal laws. Now this is very relevant in the context of anti-sexual harassment laws. There's a very strict guideline by the Supreme Court which says what you need to do when you open a startup, what you need to do to respect the women the way they deserve it, to give them the appropriate place in the organization, which I'll come to a little later in the presentation. Unintentional failed banking transactions could invite legal notices. For example, if you write a check to someone and the check bounces, you might, if you're not aware of the law, consider that this is a very small thing, but actually you could be put into a lot of trouble. Use of wrong words could invite trouble. Writing an email about your vendor to another vendor, or putting on Facebook bad words about your clients, could actually invite a legal notice from other party's lawyer. Now basically, Indian criminal law is divided into three reams: Indian Penal Code, Code of Criminal Procedure, and Indian Evidence Act. As I said earlier, there are many more acts, many more legislations and statutes which go into the realm of criminal law, but we are not going there because of the paucity of time. We'll just limit ourselves to these three acts. Indian Penal Code basically defines what the offenses are. Criminal Procedure Code tells you how to go about lodging those offenses and getting the justice. And Evidence Act basically talks about how to prove your case in the court. Now at a glance, the issues I'm going to touch, the first one is sexual harassment. As I told you, anti-sexual harassment is a very important topic, is very close to my heart, because I believe even now in 2013, Indian women are not being provided with all the due respect they deserve. And I understand that you all are modern people, you all are new age entrepreneurs, and you must be thinking to having a policy even at the beginning of the commencement of your business to see how you respect women, how you respect your women colleagues at the office place. And we'll talk about it a little later. Second topic I'm going to touch is defamation. As I said, sometimes we use words we should not be using, and if those words go out in the public or to a third party who was not part of that dialogue, you could be sued for defamation, or there could be criminal proceedings as well. Third one is bouncing of check. You'll get into a lot of monetary transactions in the course of your business, and this is something which I generally feel that Indians take a little too lightly. You cut a check out for someone, you know, there's no money in the account, you thought of putting the money before the check gets into the processing, you're not able to do it, it bounces, though you had the intention to put the money before the check reaches that stage, but you will be liable for under the criminal law. Then comes cheating. Cheating is something which talks about deception, but is itself very deceiving. I might not have the intention to cheat you, but you know, the other party's lawyer could always make out a case saying that they always had the intention to cheat his party. So we'll talk about that a little later. Then comes forgery. Forgery in the layman's term means representing a document which was not written or signed by you, or manipulating a document, which on which I will talk a little later. Then comes criminal breach of trust, which basically means I trusted you and you breached that trust by doing some acts which we never promised between us, or by not doing some acts which we promised between us. Then comes a very important issue of falsification of accounts. Many a times in my practice I've seen that startups, when they go out for funding, they inflate their sales. If the sale is 2 crores, they'll say it's 3 crores. So, you know, it would not mean much for a funder who's there to help you, but if he wants to put you into legal trouble, he can very well succeed in that. So one after the other, we'll talk about all these topics. Sexual harassment, first of all. Unwelcome sexual advances, requests for sexual favors, and other verbal or physical conduct of a sexual nature constitutes sexual harassment when submission or rejection of this conduct affects an individual's employment, unreasonably interferes with an individual's work performance, or creates an intimidating, hostile, or offensive work environment. Many a time, especially in startups when the work environment is very open, is very free, entrepreneurs tend not to provide all the respect the women folk deserve. For example, they could come and pat on the back of a women colleague. If she's a very good friend, she won't mind. But if she minds that, she could put you into trouble, and rightfully so. So you gotta take care of all these little things. Women are special, and they deserve all the respect we can give them. Sexual harassment at workplace is a violation of women's right to gender equality, life and liberty. It creates an insecure and hostile work environment which discourages women's participation in work, thereby adversely affecting their economic empowerment and the goal of inclusive growth. Someone, long back rightly said, I don't remember who, that the biggest development India could ever have is women empowerment. And I believe any young, new entrepreneur should make this a motto and always believe in that. I'll tell you a little about the famous Vishakha case, which was on sexual harassment, and in terms of which the Honorable Supreme Court laid down some guidelines. A social worker from Rajasthan, Banvari Devi, was gang raped by a group of upper class influential men because she tried to stop the insidious practice of child marriage. Banvari Devi was determined to get justice and lodged a case against the offenders. However, the accused was acquitted by a trial court because everyone, including the village authorities, police, doctors, dismissed her situation. Now, this is the case when Supreme Court for the very first time said every organization must have inculcated in their HR policies a very solid, robust policy against sexual harassment. Now, these are the basic guidelines laid by the Honorable Supreme Court, and I'm just reading a few of them. It is the onus of the employer to include a rule in the company code of conduct for preventing sexual harassment. So, again, perfecting those details. You've opened a company or about to open a company, you must have HR policy in place. And in that HR policy, you must provide for a very solid code of conduct for the Prevention of Sexual Harassment Act. Organizations must establish complaint committees that are headed by women. There are 10 people who are required to join the committee. One of them has to be from an NGO. They have to be women folk. So you could go through those guidelines. I'll be happy to provide each one of you those guidelines after this presentation is over. And I can coordinate with the people who are helping me out to reach to you. And then you could try see how you could very well inculcate that in your HR policies. Initiate disciplinary action against the offenders and safeguard the interests of the victim. So if something happens to the woman, she feels insulted or she feels harassed, she has a right to come to you, you being the owner of the company or the chairman, managing director, CEO, whatever, and it is your job to see that the justice is granted to women folk. Female employees shall be made aware of their rights. Not only that, it is your job and it is your duty, if any women folk join your organization, to let them know that these are their rights, this is our policy, this is the code of conduct. If you feel someone is breaching that code of conduct, please let us know. Now I come to defamation. As I said, there are words which you use sometimes in business which could be interpreted by others as defaming. Now what is the law? What is the criminal law? Now, defamation falls both under civil and criminal laws. I'll not talk about civil laws because of the paucity of time. I'll talk about criminal laws. And I'll read you the section which governs this particular issue. Whoever, by words, either spoken or intended to be read, or by signs, or by visible representation, makes or publishes any imputation concerning any person intending to harm or knowing or having reason to believe that such imputation will harm the reputation of such person is said, except in cases hereinafter accepted, to defame that person. We won't go into it, the exception, I'll just tell you what this means. What this means is that you don't have to write only, you don't have to make signs, you don't have to just make, it could be published or it could be either of these. Imputation means you're attributing something to someone. For example, I say that my colleague ABC has a certain kind of disease and I email it to everyone. Now that person might have the disease or he might not have it. But I had no right to defame him in that order. So the intention, the language of that content has to be seen. if it was written in sympathy, so that everyone could be sympathetic towards him or her, it could be fine. But if it was written to just to let everyone know that this particular person has that disease and there was no good intention behind that, this could be very well fall under defamation. Like I said, if you write emails about your vendors, about your funders, about your mentors, about your employees within the organization or to third parties, be very careful. You don't have to do that. If you have a problem, better pick up the phone, have a word with him in a decent language. Don't misuse the email. Don't write something thinking you're not signing it. You're just sending an email and it would not have any repercussions. It would very well have those criminal implications on you. Now, what's the punishment for defamation? Whoever defames another shall be punished with simple imprisonment for a term which may extend to 2 years, or fine, or both. So don't do that. Now, I'll just give you a couple of examples telling you what defamation has been considered to be by international and Indian courts, both in the civil and the criminal context. In one of the cases, in a newspaper, it was published that a girl had been kidnapped by a dog, doping gang, and kept in a flat at Kilburn during a specified period. The plaintiff produced witnesses who deposed that on reading the article, they understood that he was in some way connected with the gang. The jury awarded the damages to the plaintiff. In another matter, two persons jointly wrote a letter containing defamatory matters about the plaintiff and sent the same to the plaintiff by registered post. The court held that there was no publication by one person to the other. It would not amount to publication even in that case where the registered letter addressed to the plaintiff goes in the hand of a third person who reads it out in an unauthorized manner. For example, A is talking to, or A is writing an email to B, and he might be using some language which is not very healthy. This is not defamation. And it is also not defamation if that email illegally is somehow procured by C, who now claims that B was defamed by A. So the case won't be made out. Now, more examples of defamation, including some celebrities, just to provide more clarity to you. Sharon Stone sued her plastic surgeon for allegations that he told several magazines that she had a facelift. Facelift is not a disease, but she never wanted that everyone should be told. Telling someone that a certain person has a sexually transmitted disease. An employer claiming an employee stole equipment. Saying a restaurant is serving meat for dogs. Coming back to the previous example, an employer claiming an employee stole equipment. So if you're an employer, you have doubts, but just only doubts, that there has been some illegal activity by any of your employees. You don't go on writing emails to everyone saying, don't talk to him, or this guy has done this, because you don't have the proof yet. It's not been proven yet. It hasn't reached the courts. It hasn't even reached your own internal committee. So avoid that. Relating that someone is incompetent at their job. Don't keep on telling other employees that ABC is not a competent employee. He's not doing his job well. If you don't have a case made out, if you don't have proof, if there's no action being taken against him and everyone agrees to that, never do that. When blood was found in the tub at the Intercontinental Hotel in London, a housekeeper claimed Lady Gaga bathed in blood as a part of a satanic ritual. This was again made out to be a case of defamation. A newspaper knowingly prints an article falsely asserting that a public figure has cheated on business partners in the past. The newspaper, if it does not have any proof of that, any reasonable doubt coming out of court of law, they can't go about defaming others. A person falsely tells a prospective buyer of the home of a neighbor that the neighbor cheated him in the past, causing the buyer to back out of the sale. During a casual conversation with a reporter, a police official states that a suspect in a current investigation is guilty. So this is a very strict law. It implies on the police officers, the protectors of the law as well. It is their duty to see they do not defame anyone who's not been charged yet. Now we come to bouncing of checks. The act which deals with bouncing of checks in India It's called the Negotiable Instrument Act with regard to check bouncing. Basics of the acts, I'll just come to a little later. First I'll tell you what bouncing of check means. If I cut a check out for someone and if it comes back saying that there was not sufficient money in the account, or I myself call the bank and say stop the payment, that's covered under bouncing of check. So if you were under the impression that if there's no money in the account, that's bouncing, but you can very well anytime call the bank and say don't clear the check, make a stop payment, it's not covered, you are under a mistaken belief, you gotta take care of it. I'll just read a few lines of section 138. Where any check drawn by a person on an account maintained by him with a banker for payment, or any amount of money to another person from out of that account for the discharge in whole or in part of any debt or other liability is returned by the bank unpaid, either because of the amount of money standing to the credit of that account is insufficient to honor the check, or that it exceeds the amount arranged to be paid from that account by an agreement made with that bank, such person shall be deemed to have committed an offense under section 138. So what does that mean? That means if I cut a check for ABC saying that this is my gift to you and it bounces, that's not an offense because I had no debt to be paid back to you. There was nothing I was liable under. There was no amount which you could claim for me. It was just a gift. But if I bought something, if I took some services, as would happen in your cases and you're cutting checks, there was a legal debt there and you were supposed to pay. So in any of the circumstances, you'll be held liable. So take it very, very seriously. Now I'll just read through these four lines which basically say what makes out this offense. There should not be any legal liability, existing debt, exclusion gift. The validity period should not have expired. Notice to the drawer within 15 days should be given once you know it has been committed. In case some payment was due to you and the check has bounced, you have to take an immediate action. The drawer of the check should not fail to make the payment of the said amount of money to the payee or to the holder in due course within 30 days of the receipt of the said notice. If it doesn't happen, you have the right to go to the courts. Punishment under section 138 may extend to 1 year or with fine, which may extend to twice the amount of the check or with both. The term of punishment was extended to 2 years via an amendment in 2002. Please make a note of that. A very small example of what I was telling you earlier, that stop payment instructions will not take a case out of the purview of section 138. I'm quite sure not everyone knows that how serious even stop payments can be. So please make a serious note of that. Now this is again a few points about that which I've already told you about 138. You can go through these later when you have spare time. We'll come to cheating now. Cheating is an offense under section 415 of Indian Penal Code. In terms of the section, whoever by deceiving any person fraudulently or dishonestly induces the person so deceived to deliver any property to any person or to consent that any person shall retain any property or intentionally induces the person so deceived to do or omit to do anything which he would not do or omit if he were not so deceived, and which act or omission causes or likely to cause damage or harm to that person in body, mind and reputation of property is said to cheat. For example, you're going out for money for your business and you say we already have a growing business, we have this office, we have 20 people working for us, please invest, we want to grow to 40 people now, though in fact you never had those 20 people and you have paid money, you have cheated the other guy. So avoid that, don't do that, be very fair, be very honest with everyone you're dealing with. The main ingredients of cheating, one is deception. You have to deceive someone to come under the purview of this offense. Fraudulent or dishonest intention. The intention has to be dishonest, which means if your intentions were not dishonest, you know, your lawyers could very well defend you in the courts and say he never intended to cheat, it was just an error. Then there are other points which are, because of paucity of time, I'm not reading through. You could very well read them when you have time after the presentation. I'll just read through a couple of examples of when cheating was held to be cheating by the courts. Where a student writing the IAS exam indicated that he belonged to the scheduled caste and got an appointment in the cadre, the court said the accused guilty of fraudulent representation as under section 420. Where a supplier consigned a small quantity of goods to be delivered to the railways but tampered with the railway receipt to show larger consignments had been delivered, it was held that the accused was guilty under section 420. This means that you have to be very fair in your dealing. What you promise, you deliver. What you represent, you do. Whoever cheats and thereby dishonestly induces the person deceived, any property to any person, to make, alter, destroy the whole or any part of a valuable security or anything which is signed or sealed and which is capable of being converted into a valuable security, shall be punished with imprisonment of either description for a term which may extend to 7 years and shall be liable to fine. Now you know how long a man or a woman can go inside for this offense. We come to forgery. Forgery would mean you getting into a contract with someone, then taking that contract, for example, in your very specific scenarios, going to a funder, saying this is the contract and we already have a vendor, but in fact you added a couple of lines in that agreement after the agreement was executed with that vendor. That will be forgery in layman terms. I know no one does that among you. Just letting you know that if an agreement is signed, it is executed. There's not a single line you could either alter, add or delete if you do not have the consent of the other party. So be very careful of that. Forgery means fraudulent making or alteration of any record, deed, writing, instrument, register, stamp, etc. to the prejudice of another man's right. It is a false making of any written instrument for the purpose of fraud or deceit, including every alteration of or addition to a true instrument. Forgery is the false making or materially altering with intent to defraud of any writing which, if genuine, might apparently be of legal efficacy or the foundation of a legal liability. I won't read through more. You could ask me any question in the end, in the question answer round. Now, these are the elements of forgery. Number one is the document or electronic record or the part of it must be false. In fact, it must have been made dishonestly or fraudulently within the meaning of the word used in section 464. The making of false document or electronic record should be with intent to do that. Punishment for forgery is given there, which extends to 2 years or with fine or with both. Now we come to criminal breach of trust. IPC defines criminal breach of trust in the following words: whoever being in any manner entrusted with property or with any dominion over property dishonestly misappropriates or converts to his own use that property or dishonestly uses or disposes of that property in violation of any direction of law prescribing the mode in which such trust is to be discharged or of any legal contract expressed or implied which he has made touching the discharge of such trust or willfully suffers any other person to do so commits criminal breach of trust. If you're giving money by a company to invest in a particular business, you have to invest that in that particular business. You can't use it for your own use, buying your own properties or investing for your own personal good. You have to be very careful that you cannot later say that I invested that money so that I could get more interest and I could put more money back in the business. This happens all the time, so you have to be very careful. Now these are again the essential elements which I'm not reading through. Punishment for criminal breach of trust may extend to 3 years. Now falsification of accounts again is very crucial, and I think this is the last topic in the presentation. Whoever being a clerk, officer or servant or employed or acting in the capacity of a clerk, officer or servant willfully and with intent to defraud, destroys, alters, mutilates or falsifies any book, electronic record, paper, writing, valuable security or account which belongs to or is in the possession of his employer or has been received by him for or on behalf of his employer, or willfully and with intent to defraud, makes or abets the making of any false entry in, or omits or alters or abets the omission or alteration of any material particular of any security or account, shall be said to be conducting falsification of accounts. For example, one of your employees has a duty to make sales records. He does not make entries for all the sales, or he does not, or he makes false entries of sales, which never happens. That's falsification of accounts. And if you are working on a statement of accounts, and if you add something into the accounts after they've been audited, that's falsification of accounts. So you and your accountants have to be very careful. Now, this was my presentation, very brief. I did not want to bore you, and I hope I haven't. If there's any query you may have, please raise it to me, and I'll be very pleased to answer that. You have all my wishes, and best of luck to you in all your endeavors. And Coach Rent Company is always there to mentor you, to help you in your business. And you could take my cell phone number from the people who are assisting us here. My thanks to everyone, including and most importantly to Abhishek Dhar for organizing this. And please ask me if you have any queries.
Mr. Ricky, you are able to hear me? This topic is, you know, a bit complex topic.
Huh?
Anyhow, what it causes, you have actually given a very good presentation. You see, I have one sensitive question. Let us say that what it is, we are a business.
Thank you, sir.
The object of the organization is to nurture and promote entrepreneurship. And you have money.
Right.
You have money given by, let us say, some organization in the form of a grant.
Right.
To be exclusively used for promoting business. It to be exclusively used for promoting business. Startups.
Right.
In the case of startups, you know that what you call the survival rate.
Right.
It's a very tricky issue.
Right. Right.
Now, let us say under agreement, you have actually given some amount of money to a startup company. And there is actually a genuine problem, because it's a technology-related development, and there's a genuine problem. Company is not able to take off. Now, if we resort to legal issues, see, what can happen is because the company may completely get ruined. So, in that case, what do you advise?
Uh-huh.
In such a case, what do you advise?
I understand.
Yeah, I'm Suresh Bhatt from NIT Suratkal.
Right. May I have your name, gentlemen, please? Okay, Mr. Bhatt, that's a very genuine and a very good question. As I said out in my presentation, if there is a dishonest intention of someone to misappropriate that fund, only then he or she or that company will be liable under the criminal laws. If the money was taken, there was a valid contract, a genuine contract, and all the terms of the contract were not one-sided, and if the contract provided that this is a money and there is no guarantee of return, this is the business plan which has been validated by the funders, you very well have the case when you can say, we tried our best, the business couldn't take off, so I can promise you that there will be no criminal liability against you. Criminal liability arises only when the other side could prove one of the few things. For example, that you misappropriated the money, you never got into the business which you promised, you manipulated the accounts, showed us false results during the course of the business when more money was about to come, or when the business never actually existed and there was no intention of the entrepreneurs to start or kick off that business. The other party has to prove this to take you to the courts or to the police station. If you genuinely believe, and if the case is that you tried and you have everything to prove that you were working for the business and working in favor of the other party's investments, trying to make money for them, but it never took off for ABC reasons which were out of your control, or the business couldn't take off because of a disease of a founder, because of any unavoidable circumstances which nowhere is close to a criminal act, don't worry, no one can come after you. Even if they try, their criminal complaints would be quashed. The only thing you have to keep in mind is that when you get into a contract with that funder, you have to be very clear that you do not overpromise him, you do not write something which in your heart you believe is not 100% guaranteed. You know, circumstances change, people change, employees change, the strength of an organization changes, so things change. So don't overpromise yourself. If you haven't, and if you're diligently working toward the common goal, no one can come after you.
May I ask one more question to
you? I hope I've answered.
You see, suppose a student studying in the college, let us say he is in the second or third year of engineering.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Now he wants to start a company. Now, is it legally permissible to support him with money and draw him into entering agreement with an institution and all that? Because basically the company is not there, but the intention is to start a company around that product. So can the student be entertained to take up those activities when he is a side-by-side person? When side-by-side he is
100% he can be entertained?
Yes.
100% he can be entertained? Side-by-side of his studies? 100% he can do that. The only thing he has to see is there is no agreement between him and the organization or the university school he is studying in, which has stipulated that he will not do any commercial activity out of the purview of that organization. So if there is no agreement, he very well has the right. And you know, if you have read the newspaper last month, the youngest entrepreneur in India we have is, I think, 12-year-old who is making beautiful apps for Apple, for Apple products. So he can very well do that. You just have to see that contractually he is not bound in not doing this activity. You can very well get into an MOU with him. If he doesn't have a company, you can provide all the support, stipulating that a company in future will be kicked off, and till that time we are supporting him. There's nothing illegal in that.
NOC from your university or from the department, that they have no objection of your starting a company and all that.
It is good for you if you receive an NOC. The reason being, you do not know what contract he's under with the obligation with the organization. So tomorrow, if he gets into a contract with you, but the university, very very rough example, sues him and makes you a party as well, saying that you know the student never had a right to go commercially, leaving his education, and going into a business contract, then you would be not harassed, but you could be making your visits to the courts. It's always good that you keep yourself safe. Ask the student to get an NOC. Talk to that organization and see that they have no objection. If they have nothing in written and still they have an objection, that could be talked about. But if you still want to go on, you can very well go on. Most welcome. Any other question? So I have another query on chat from Pranveer Singh, Institute of Technology. The query is, how important is jurisdiction in the discussed offenses? Now, there were, I think, 7 offenses I discussed in the presentation. Cheating, falsification of accounts, criminal breach of trust, defamation, etc., sexual harassment. Jurisdiction in law is always important. It's always very important. Now, if your query is that if I have given a check to someone and I'm sitting in Delhi, it bounces in Bombay, no one can say anything to me? No. You'll be held liable. You could be held liable in Bombay as well. And if your query is that I'm sitting in Delhi writing an email about someone who's sitting in US, but I'm writing an email in Sweden, you could be held liable anywhere out of these 3 jurisdictions under their respective laws. So jurisdiction matters. But jurisdiction matters only to the extent of where the person who has committed this offense be called for questioning by the police or by the court of law. So jurisdiction is very important. But again, I don't think under any of the offenses I've discussed, and if I remember correctly what all offenses I discussed, you can come out of the offense just on the question of jurisdiction. So you have to be very careful. Jurisdiction is not something which will save you. Jurisdiction is something which possibly could delay the process of prosecution in the courts, because you or the other party could go in the court saying the jurisdiction of this particular city is, or of this court is not made out. If they have to come after me, they have to go to Bombay or some other state, or, you know, an example like, examples like these. So it is important, but not very important if you want to really learn and know how, even unintentionally, you don't get into the purview of criminal laws. Please feel free to ask any queries if you have. Abhishek just told me if you don't have any queries at the moment, you could always send me an email. You have my email on the last slide of the presentation, and I'll be very happy to assist you. As I said, Cochran and Company is always willing to mentor new startups, new entrepreneurs, new age companies. Feel very free to call me up or even fix an appointment with me. I'll be very happy to meet with you. So at this note, I'll end the presentation. It was lovely speaking with you, I hope we have many more presentations in the future. I'll be interested to listen to most of you if ever you make a presentation, and learn what you're doing, and assist you in any manner as I could.